Walt Averill, some Powers John's Lane Irish whiskey for my favourite Irish. Bolcha Rash, we're not at a bar this time, Walt, are we?
No, it's an office.
we normally welcome people back to my bar, but we're in the global headquarters of Kappa Bunga.
Yes. And this is the president's office, which we're subleasing for this show. So,
okay, and the president actually is keeping an eye on us because
yes,
the
president, she is present. She,
Myra Murphy, is over there behind the camera. So, thank you for having us.
Thank you.
I've known Myra for a number of years and got to meet you. I know you are the big whiskey drinker in your house.
Yes, I'm the only whiskey drinker in the house. So there you go, and without the occasional sip from Myra, but yes, that's just me.
And we've talked, you know, ahead of time about getting this arranged, and you said you enjoy a Redbreast, which many people will know is my gateway whiskey into this journey, but that your ultimate or your top level would be?
It's the Powers John Lane, for sure. Although I do love the Redbreast 12-year and the sherry cask as well, but this is definitely my number one.
Okay, and we brought all of them with us, all the Powers collection, all the Powers family with us here today, but we'll sip on this in a few minutes.
Excellent.
So you've been a whiskey drinker long before I've been a whiskey drinker. And you were smuggling Redbreast into this country decades ago.
Yes, indeed. Well, Myra is from Belfast, and so we would visit often, family over there. And her brother lives just a couple doors down from a great liquor store called The Vineyard.
Okay.
And they specialize in unique and kind of more craft type things. And he turned me on to the store and to Redbreast 20 years ago or so, but you couldn't buy it here at the time. So every time we went for a visit, I would buy a bottle, which progressed to buying a case, which was three bottles that we would carry back on the plane home with us. So we had some Redbreast at home.
Okay. And when you got it back here, how long would those three bottles have lasted?
3 days? No, it's longer. Definitely longer than that, but I don't know. That's too long ago.
And so you would be, you've obviously seen then Redbreast has evolved. Do you drink any of the other expressions in the range, or are you still
I've had them. I still, my favorite between all of them is still the 12-year-old basic Redbreast, which is still delicious. I had some last week when I was down in San Francisco. It was great. But I always, when I would have Redbreast, I would always go to our local place, Bottle Barn, and I would buy the Powers Gold Label, which in those days was, in fact, a gold label.
Yeah.
And it was $13, $14, and that was the everyday thing because it was so tasty for the price.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, we're talking about whiskeys, which have been around for decades in Ireland, but are getting a new lease of life, which is, which is fantastic. So I'm going to pour a few drops, but I know Myra, through what you guys do for business. Met her first, goodness.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I want to say how many years ago it was, but quite a while back. And you guys started a business from scratch, and you're now about to take over the world with something really fun and novel, which I suppose touches on whiskey, but wine is your focus for that. So, yeah, Kappa Bunga.
Yeah, so we started Kappa Bunga probably 10, 11, 12 years ago, somewhere in there. It all started with this, which is the original product, Kappa Bunga, which is basically a cap that reseals a bottle of wine that looks like a bung that would go in a wine barrel, thus Kappa Bunga. Myra came up with the name. She's good at inventing words. But we sell them with different logos and expressions on there. This is our most popular Save Water Drink wine. But we also do some sassy ones like this that say drunken grown-ups, which I hope to become at some point.
Drunken or grown-up?
Yeah, both. Both. but we do a number of products for food and wine, and it's been a really fun experience. We're from the wine industry, and so we had to learn an entire new industry, and it's been really gratifying, and it's a very collaborative industry, which we didn't find the wine business was when we left it. So it's been really interesting learning new ways to sell and commiserating with other manufacturers about, you know, issues in production and shipping and all those good things. And
supply chain
issues. Well, thankfully, we've been pretty fortunate with that, but we've had our share of hiccups for sure.
Okay. Started with the cap and obviously Capabunga. We'll share the website on the video. Folks can buy these direct from you.
Absolutely.
Okay, mm-hmm. But I know you guys have worked incredibly hard on getting distribution, and you're with some of the big name retailers across the country.
Well, let's see. Total Wine is a very, very great customer of ours. Online, there's a company called Food 52 that started out of the New York Times food writer started this business, and they sell a lot of our more food-related products like our Cheese Vault and the Market Tote. Also places like Sur La Table, William Sonoma, the Container Store. Those are some of the biggies, but the bulk of our business is still small independent retail.
Okay, so a few A-list names in there.
A few, yes.
Yeah, well done.
Thanks to Myra.
Well done to you guys. No, it's because I remember when I first met Myra all that time ago, she was doing the rounds here in northern Sonoma County and knocking on doors of wineries and tasting rooms, etc. And you've come from that to having this A-list of customers.
It's pretty crazy. And it's, you know, naturally when we came up with this product, we thought, oh, this is a shoe-in for the wine business. But we found quite the opposite. And Myra really struggled to get into doors and through doors at those days. And being Myra, she got very frustrated and figured everybody needed one of these. So she took it to the gift side of the business. And that's when everything blew up. So the funny part about that is once we really got a foothold in the gift industry, that's when the wineries started calling. They would find the product and say, hey, we're really interested in this. And it's like, yeah, we showed it to you before.
Yeah. It's funny. Any plans for a whiskey Capabunga cap?
Is there? No, the thing is with spirits, the bottles are all different shapes. You know, wine is fairly consistent. So
yeah.
I've racked my brain, believe me, with different kind of spirits-oriented products. But a cap isn't one of them because it's just not as universal as the wine.
Makes sense. Yeah, because obviously, you know, the new bottlings
of
these guys.
They can be square or triangles.
They've got the flange on top. Yeah. That makes sense. The one thing I was always fascinated about when I first met Myra and she showed me the concept back then, and I think she used the term, you put this on the top of a bottle when you've got leftover wine. To Mitch, my response was leftover wine, ?
Yes, and so, after 12 years of this, we've come up with various responses, which range from things like, it's good for the second bottle.
Ba-bum.
But you obviously don't pour a whole bottle in your glass at one time, so it's also good, especially if you need something to go in the fridge and lay on its side in between glasses, it works great for that.
But. And you've talked also as a marketing tool for wine industry.
Oh, for sure.
They're made from silicone, isn't that?
Food grade silicone.
Yeah. So they last forever.
They do. We have the original one still in our drawer.
So it's and I have some in our house. I got some from a neighbor here of yours because we're in the beverage district here in Windsor. William Allen at Two Shepherds. So
oh yeah,
I love his wine. Still get it, and I've got two of his. I've got some from the folks at Visit Napa Valley that are still being used in our house. So
and they're both still customers too. Yeah.
So no, fantastic. It's we'll talk more about some of your fun products, but we should actually toast.
Okay.
First. Sláinte.
Sláinte.
Yeah, great to be here. So what is it? What is it you love about this?
You know, I used to drink Scotch whiskey before I met Myra, and I was coerced into trying Irish whiskey, thankfully. But the thing for me, I just always felt like the Irish whiskey is more complex and more fruity, and I really like that. I mean, it's not that I dislike Scotch, but this is a completely different animal, and I guess the long and the short of it is I just get more pleasure out of it, which is what it's all about, you know?
Yeah, if you're going to spend your dollars on a nice bottle, you want to be
enjoying it. This one always reminds me of pears,
That's one of the pot still characters. That and the spice spectrum is, and it's interesting you talk about Power's Gold label. Obviously, this is the Power's Gold label of today, even though it's red.
It's orange, and I happen to love orange.
Okay, here, let's put them side by side.
There we go. Yeah.
Okay, you're the orange lover. And we're not far from the Golden Gate, so that's where you can argue about red and international
there
orange
you go,
and all
fair
that.
Enough,
so,
fair
but
enough.
But I think this as a bottle of whiskey is arguably the best value for an entry point drinking whiskey.
I could not agree more. It's 100%.
And I think also for bartenders, because I know it weighs in on the, let me check there, 43% for bartenders. I think it's a great base for a cocktail because they love that little bit of elevated alcohol when they're building a cocktail. And it's, you know, a bit of a spice character in there too. Obviously, Three Swallows in between, but this is just it's a whole new world on the flavor front.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, I can see why it's your favorite. Even though Redbreast got you in here, this
definitely. But I mean, and again, I still love Redbreast. But if I had to pick, this would be my desert island for sure.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we talked about the caps that came from Bungs, the Capabunga. You've got a much bigger range now. You're ticking all the boxes in terms of serving different markets, and we talked before we started recording about various things, and you've got your own version here of a hip flask.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
To speak.
So this is a company called Tote and Able that it's a couple of brothers that about 7 miles away that we met through the industry, and they were in the gift business for 30 years and they wanted to retire. And so they approached us and we thought it was a great fit with the rest of our products. So we ended up buying the company and started making the flasks ourselves. And they've done very well for us. It's a fun product. They're covered in canvas so we can print virtually anything on them. Yeah. But inside there's a plastic liner, and crucially it comes with a shot glass. So I actually had the good fortune of playing golf at Pebble Beach, and I took this one there with John Lane inside of it and shared it with the caddies. Sticks, he was 6'7", and I think he drank most of the flask.
He's taller than you.
He's taller than me, yes.
Wow, because, you know, I'm pretty short compared to everyone else. So, a great idea, and obviously, you know, easy to clean, hygienic,
absolutely,
all that sort of thing.
You can fold it up and put it in your pocket, yeah.
So, obviously, you know, to take Myra's hand, you had to convert from Scotch to Irish whiskey.
It was a struggle.
you don't seem to be struggling too much now. Where would you have first experienced whiskey and exposure to it when you were growing up?
That's a good question. I think I'm gonna say I started in the wine business when I was fairly young, and I would say it was through there. I don't remember having whiskey before I was in the wine business, but this is a lot of years ago. So I think that's probably where it started. And then I didn't really develop a real love for whiskey until we started importing a Scotch whiskey, a small producer. And I bonded with the family and just really got to know them well. And I think that's when I really started to develop more of a taste for whiskey at that point. But I don't think I'd ever had whiskey really, maybe in college. I don't know. Can't remember that. But maybe until I was in the wine business.
Okay. It wasn't part of the family growing up?
No, my parents were wine drinkers.
Okay.
Yeah. They had wine on the table every night. And that's how I ended up getting in the wine business because I just developed an interest in it. And they would encourage us to try the wine. My two older brothers were never really interested in tasting it, but I always was. And I used to come up to the wine country up here with my mom, and she would taste wines, and I would collect corks and labels. And when I was 12, 13, 14 years
old.
And
you're a bit of a wine geek at an early age.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So it's funny, but never really spirits.
Okay.
Although my dad, he liked gin. So every year on his birthday, I always have a gin.
Okay. I won't ask how old you were when you were having a gin on those birthdays. So you were originally from down south.
Southern California.
SoCal. But we're up here in NorCal. Wine brought you up here?
Exactly. Yep. The wine business. So I started working for a winery here called Deloach Vineyards back in...
You don't have to say something.
I can't even remember. I moved here in 1994 after I'd already started working for them. So I've been here ever since.
Okay. Yeah. And this is obviously now home. You've met Myra. You've raised a daughter.
She's
she's
off at college.
But she's, they're never gone.
No. I talked to her for about 45 minutes today. So she's been great, you know, of really keeping in touch. And she's in the midst of finals, so she needs a little extra TLC right now.
And you mentioned a couple of minutes ago, you mentioned Pebble Beach. And I know that you love to golf.
Mm.
And I know that Roisin loves to golf too.
She does.
And I think you're responsible for that. Did you drag her out when she was young?
Well, I used to, because I've been playing golf since I was 7. And I thought, well, she should definitely learn. And so I used to ask her if she wanted to go to the driving range or to the putting green, which is where we spent most of our time. And she would sometimes say yes. Often she would say no. And then I discovered the trick. And I would say, Roisin, you want to go get a donut? And she would say, yeah. And I said, and you want to go to the golf course after that? Oh, okay. So I bribed her into it, and then she grew to love it.
Okay, because I can remember when I would play golf, and we don't really do golf carts in Ireland. It's not a thing. You either walk or carry your bag, but golf carts are a thing here, and that was always my hook for getting my kids out. Do you want to drive the cart?
Yeah, I rarely ever go in a cart. We Roisin and I would always walk. The only time we would ever take a cart is when we would go up the coast to Sea Ranch.
Okay.
And it was just a little treat that we would take a cart. But other than that, we always walk and carry our clubs.
Okay.
Old school.
Yeah. No, the way it should be in many ways. So I'm going to get you to kind of put on the Sonoma County tourism hat for a minute here. So golf, this is a tough one. Favorite course in the county?
Well, my favorite course in the county is Windsor Golf Course. And it's not just because I've been playing there for 25 years. It's fun. It's interesting. It's challenging. It's fair. The people are very nice, very supportive of local golf. So I definitely would say that's my favorite place. I think the most difficult course is Fountain Grove. I would say I've played my Comet as well, and it's a beautiful course. I love it, but it's not as difficult as Fountain Grove. So, but I would still say Windsor is my favorite.
Okay, and I have to say, you know, I live over the hill in the next county over. You put us to shame here in this county with your selection of golf courses.
That is true.
You know, you haven't even touched on Bodega out of the coast,
oh, beautiful,
which has got
yeah.
stunning views out there.
Yep.
You kind of have all types and stripes and shades mm-hmm. of golf courses mm-hmm. here, which is fantastic.
Absolutely, including like Sea Ranch links, you know, link style.
Yeah, no. And beyond the county, favorite course? Well, let's actually
beyond the county favorite course. Now it's a tough one.
So let's tie it to the whiskey. So
okay.
Favorite course in Ireland?
Favorite course in Ireland is Royal County Down, which I have had the good fortune to play twice this last summer with our daughter, and I played there 2 days before we got married because we had our reception at the Sleeve Donard, which is the hotel right next to the golf course.
Fantastic.
So that's definitely my favorite.
Okay.
Ballybunion this summer was pretty special too.
Yes, that's two great courses you just named.
Yeah.
Great.
It's great.
Great.
But Pebble Beach I would rank right up there.
Okay. back to whiskey and glasses. I know Myra's family has a long and storied and colourful history in the licensed trade in and around Belfast. And as we were talking back and forth about doing this, she said that there was some old memorabilia that you've pulled out here.
Yeah, so we brought this out this morning. So Myra's grandfather had a wine and spirits wholesale business, but he started by buying bars and then started the wholesale business to supply the bars and other accounts as well. And Myra's mother worked in the business as well. And Myra actually worked in it for a short period of time. But he was, as best we understand it, he was the first person to ever put his logo on a glass for a bar. And so this is actually Waterford glass.
Really?
I don't think it's crystal. It's Waterford crystal?
No.
Yeah, glass. And has the Sam Casey's and Son logo on that. So I use this glass for special occasions.
So would that have been, obviously it's a small enough glass. But mm-hmm. Do you know, was that used for serving any particular drinks in it? Was it a measure of whiskey?
Or? I assume it was just whiskey glass.
Yeah. And obviously you say one of the first logoed glasses. When would that be from? When would it date from?
60s? Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe 1960. Earlier, yeah.
1960s.
Yeah, quite a while ago.
Yeah.
And then this was another glass from the bar.
Look at this
with the
beauty.
Old Bushmills logo on it. And this is what they would use for a hot whiskey. And it's got this nice little stem, has nice little pads to hold it. Hot whiskey, very good thing if you're feeling under the weather and need to get a good night's sleep.
And folks won't really know what time of year we're shooting this video, but it's hot whiskey season.
It definitely is hot whiskey season, yes.
For sure. And then a couple of other ones over
here.
Yeah,
so this is one of my favorite glasses, especially for the John Lane. I love the shape of it. But it's also special because we bought it together when we were up in Mendocino for our anniversary 1 year. But one of the things I love about it is the nice, thick, heavy bottom. It just feels good in your hand, especially when it's got whiskey in it. And then this is my, oh gosh, it's Wednesday night and I just need just a little sip. And this works perfectly for that. And it's a famous Grouse glass that Myra's father gave to us. And but it says, you know, a small one, a single one, blah, blah, blah. Of course, it has a wee dram.
So. Of course. All the terminology that we use for our drink. Yeah. So these are obviously family heirlooms. I hope Roisin has her name on them for when her time comes.
We'll see.
Well, with the resurgence and renaissance in Irish whiskey, a lot of this memorabilia, as I would call it, mm-hmm. It's become collectible.
That's great.
It's kind of paying homage to a lot of the history, the rich history in Irish whiskey. So, absolutely. No, it's lovely that you guys still have some of these. They are fantastic. Are you a cocktail man?
I'm not generally a cocktail man, but I love a Negroni.
Okay.
So I'm not a big whiskey cocktail fan. It's really my go-to is definitely it's a Negroni. And I make a good Negroni.
Of course you do. You've had 2 years, of course, during the pandemic lockdown to perfect your Negroni.
Yes, and I'm a believer in the classic recipe of equal parts. But my little touch on it is I've got the nice gin, I've got the Carpano Antica vermouth, and then I use 2/3 Campari and 1/3 Gran Classico for the bitters in there. And the Gran Classico, it just adds just a little another dimension to it and a little touch of sweetness that is quite nice. So that's my little secret.
Just naming out the ingredients and the proportions, I know you're deadly serious about your Negroni.
Yes.
You take it very seriously.
I do.
Good. I'm going to put a couple of drops in this, Walt, if you want
Please.
To join me just to see how it changes. So.
Yeah, when I was importing the Scotch whiskey and I went over to spend some time with Hamish, and every bar in Scotland has a little jug of water on the bar, and he would explain to me why it was important because it really released the aromas.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do the same thing here.
Yeah.
And really release the aromas, and I've done that ever since. And he used to always tell me, I don't understand why people in America put ice in their whiskey, until he flew out here and I met him in Fort Lauderdale, and the doors opened up from the airport out to the parking lot, and he said, he's in his kilt, and he says, now I understand why they put ice in the whiskey.
Yeah. I had a similar story when I first came out here in 94, and I did Harvest down south and did a barbecue for the folks I was working with. And it was, I'm going to say, 98, 99, 100 degrees.
Yeah.
Nice dry heat as it is down south, which I'm grateful for.
Yeah.
And folks were arriving at the gathering bringing wine, red wine, in a cool bag.
Yeah.
And I thought it was the strangest thing because I was always schooled that you serve it at room temperature.
Yeah.
Well, when it's 100 degrees, what's room temperature? So, yeah, as I go through my journey, I'm discovering more and more the pleasure of the few drops.
Mm-hmm.
This is on the nose, it's different.
I think so.
Immediately, it's fascinating. So I find more of a kind of a nutty character mm-hmm. coming out now.
I'd say
which
so.
Is so appealing. Goodness, it's just... It's so appealing. So we've touched on the pandemic a couple of times. How was the pandemic for Capabunga?
Well, it was interesting, obviously. From a business standpoint, it was okay.
Good.
We did pretty well. Myra has an expression that people were buying like they were going to the chair. And that was certainly the case in part of the pandemic. It was a little bittersweet, though, because we had a staff here of 7 people, plus the 2 of us. And when lockdown came, we let everybody go because nobody knew what was going to happen. And we made some significant changes to how we operated our business and over the last 18 months or so. And we're to a place now where we're comfortable with where we are. And we only have 1 person back with us. Elizabeth's been with us for 9 years. And we're small but mighty. So
we've done
some outsourcing. We moved our warehouse to a logistics company, so we don't pack the orders here anymore. So it's been, the last 6 months have been interesting.
Okay. And obviously for any business as it grows, you know, you guys have got to make the hard decisions. Did lockdown / the pandemic, did it force some decisions on you that you might have been thinking about and you went, right, now's the time to do it?
Yeah, we definitely, for this product in particular, we had talked about, you know, kind of downsizing the production of it because there were so many different designs and we were doing all that manufacturing right on the other side of this wall, which is pretty labor intensive. And we had already talked about, you know, perhaps having somebody else make those for us and cutting back on the amount of designs that we did.
Okay.
And so when lockdown happened, then that was the first thing to go. That was, okay, first we got to pare this down, streamline this, you know, so we can be more effective with it. And that worked really well.
And is the business stronger as a result,
yeah,
do you think?
I think so, definitely, yeah.
Great.
And we still do custom with it too, and that's great. But we really focus people in to buy the designs that were the ones that we're really selling, you know, instead of just offering everything you could possibly have and maybe they sit on the shelf. Now yeah, they buy the ones that actually move. So,
and sometimes it's better off to offer less because you're going to get more throughput with them. So
absolutely. Myra had a mentor / sales manager back in her early days selling wine that had a famous line, you got to let go to grow.
Yeah, there's something to be said for that. And we, you know, we say less is more as well for so many mm-hmm. things. So, yeah, fantastic. So we've talked about obviously trips to Ireland. Beforehand, we talked about you guys wanting to take over the world with your wonderful product. Where's next on the list?
Next on the list, I think, is going to be Scandinavia. I mean, we already have an importer in Norway and Sweden, but we really want to conquer Denmark for okay. whatever reason. I think the products are really well suited there, especially the market tote. So I think maybe next spring, something like that, we might head over there and maybe make a little pit stop in the southwest of Ireland on the way.
Okay, and obviously you'll make sure you bring an extra suitcase to fill up at Dublin Duty Free or Cork yes. Duty Free. It's
yes.
Yeah.
Well, that's true, but we're actually fortunate. Our local purveyor here, Bottle Barn, actually has a fantastic selection of Irish whiskey and fairly priced. So
yeah.
Sometimes it's cheaper there than it is a duty free.
I would say very fairly priced.
Yeah.
It's the sort of place I've been in there a couple of times to look at the selection, and my wallet starts to worry when I walk in because they, to your point, I think I counted 65 or so different offerings on the shelf.
That sounds about right, but I would tell you that 3 years ago it was probably 12.
Yeah. Yeah. And to your point about very fairly priced.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're obviously, they're not scalping the customers, which is great. It's interesting. You know, we talk about duty free. Unfortunately, the Republic of Ireland has got a pretty horrific duty, so you can actually buy, as I did on our most recent trip, I bought a bottle of whiskey in Paris, off the shelf, so paying sales tax VAT cheaper than I could buy the same bottle in Dublin.
Yeah.
So yeah, duty is a huge part of
absolutely.
Of how the government in Ireland gets its revenue, and but obviously the industry exploding as it is, there's now thousands of people employed in the industry that weren't employed in it, you know, years back.
So, yeah, and then also the price of whiskey has gone up so much over the last 10 years that duty is, you know, multiplied,
yeah.
you know, on top of that. So
yeah, so I'm. Obviously, these are, you know, Power's been an old, John's Lane being where the old distillery was in mm-hmm. Dublin. These are Irish distillers' products made in Middleton, Cork. You know, Myra's from Belfast. Plans to visit any of the new distilleries in Belfast when you get back there next?
I mean, I'd be happy to do that. I have been known to actually make some spirits on my own with a little pot still. So it's always fascinating to me. I did a tour of a Germain Robin brandy distillery up in Mendocino County, and it was fascinating. So I would always be interested in that. I don't know the next time we'll be in Belfast, but I think it's more likely we'd be in the south before
okay.
we'd be in the north again. But
and you said the southwest, Cork, Kerry.
Yeah. Yeah. Last summer we had a trip that we started down in Dingle and worked our way up to Donegal, and but we didn't make it to Cork, and that's a place we've wanted to go.
Okay.
I've wanted to go visit. Myra's been there, of course.
Okay. But. And obviously went up the Wild Atlantic Way. And
exactly.
Yeah.
I love it there.
Yeah. It's finally, they figured out a way to market all these beautiful places on the west coast of Ireland under one heading.
Right.
You know, very diverse, very different.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, hugely popular for Irish tourism. And now you can actually do loads of great distilleries along that as well.
Yeah.
All the way from, we started in Dingle. Dingle have a phenomenal reputation. So, yeah, but in Cork, you've got a number of distilleries as well. So.
And you can play golf along the way too. So.
You've got it nailed, don't you? Right. We should probably wrap up. We'll continue chatting, you and I. But yeah, we should. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you.
Great to reconnect.
Yeah.
Sláinte over a glass of whiskey, over your favorite.
Yeah.
And yeah.
It is a Friday, so I might have to have more later.
Yeah, but the folks on video and the podcast don't know it's a Friday, but we're going to do that. So yeah, so to everyone out there, sláinte wá.
Yes.
Okay. Well done, sir.